good morning, good evening, and good noon, and like good night for all the different people in the world. So before I waste time here, I'll just jump to my slide. Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, before I even start with my slide, so let me thank Grace, Wendy from Intel, and Justin from BMAP. Yeah. So, and also thanks for all for giving me this opportunity. So, yeah. So today I'm going to give a small gist on how exactly security, how people are exactly looking at security with respect to IoT. And also I will teach a bit on how you can, more like a fun way, how you can find vulnerabilities, and also the possible way, I mean, how you can, if you're a developer, maybe I can, it might give you a rough understanding on how you can develop your hardware, software, or firmware, which is like a little bit bug-free or maybe like secure device. Yeah, so this is my, I always keep this meme in every single my slide. So if you look at most of the product, they will obviously say like their devices like AES encrypted, or they have like RSA and different kind of encryption. So if you look at the meme, so the company might tell you like they use like heavy high power encryption like your RSA, like AES-256. But the whole point of people don't understand, realize that having encryption doesn't mean your device or your entire architecture is safe. So just like in this meme, so you might think like you need a powerful computer to crack encryption. So just like a lock, so you might have a big lock, but still if your attacker gets hold of your key, then the entire point of having your encryption keys becomes pointless. So don't just blindly believe that having an encryption or these kind of encryption kind of stuff or cryptography doesn't really mean your device is secure. Yeah. So let me talk a little bit about who I am. So I'm a security researcher. So before that, I used to be in a development path. So I have built like several prototype and then even few products. So for me, security is more likely like it combines the development process. So at Attify, I work for Attify, it's a startup. So at Attify, I specialize in hardware security. I mean the embedded level security and also the software defined radios. That's where your wireless part, like your RF6 top and Z-Wave stuff. So I have also pen tested several devices from all those big time players. So like your smart bells, smart wristbands, home security system. So, and I've also been a trainer, also a speaker at several conferences. I'm lucky to say that I'm also a part of Intel Software Innovator. And then I must say it's really worth it. And I'm also being nominated as 25 out of 25 last year. Yeah. So now let's come to what exactly we are going to talk about. So what is IoT? So different people have a different meaning. So some people might say like connecting your commercial device to internet is IoT. So some people might say, okay, making my device smart and then connect to a network is IoT. So the thing about IoT is like all the meaning is correct. There is an exact definition for IoT or any of these devices. So for me, according to me, the real meaning of IoT is connecting all the things. So it doesn't have to be like a normal home automation or your smart car. So let's say your mobile phone. So your mobile phone runs on your Android. So Google can actually harvest your data from your mobile phone. So for Google, your IoT or Chrome or let's say your mobile phone, it's their hard IoT devices. So for me, any device or anything that's connected to the network, or even if it's a two device, so I would say it's an IoT connected device. Yeah. So we talked about IoT, and then right now it's all busy to say like IoT devices, we are creating IoT this, IoT training and all those stuff. But how does security right now, it's the reality is it's just like S in IoT. It doesn't really exist. Yeah. So this is one of the classic example of any IoT security. So I think most of you have already tried it. So it's shodan.io. So it's more like a Google for internet of IoT devices. So what it exactly does is like it searches for all the it's similar to nmap, so where it scans for all the public IPs and then see which you will get some details on those public IPs. So based upon those details, so this shodan.io will like list all the devices. Let's say if you search for a SCADA network, so it will give you all the public IPs that's connected to a SCADA network. So imagine if your device or a security camera is connected to a public IP and then it's open, so anyone in the world can access your device. So one simple example is there was a researcher in Florida. So he was able to see a caterpillar truck that was parked in an open internet. So the funny part about the Wi-Fi is it always connects to open internet. So the security researcher was literally able to see all the onboard information that present in the Caterpillar truck. So imagine if it's a truck. So it doesn't have much of a real hacking value. What if someone is hacking into a baby monitor system and then watching you, your privacy is invaded, right? So the second one is like it's called DAWO exploit. So this is like one of the second largest IoT manufacturers. So they manufacture security system, some sort of entrainment system, and cameras. So what they have done is like they haven't had a perfect authentication system. For example, if I as a user enter having a session with the server, so if someone is intercepting that particular connection, so again they can record it back and then do an attack and then I get the session back. So it means the server doesn't really have a authentication mechanism to see whether this particular session is valid or it's being modified or not. Yeah. Similarly, so DBL Tech, so they make like a bit of like switches and stuff. So internally, also one of the biggest problem, not problem, so mistakes which manufacturers make is like they create backdoors to their own devices. So they use it mostly for testing it, or if there's a problem, they used to do it. But they make it so obvious, like in their one of their switches, where they have created telnet session where that gives a root access. So the password, so once you reverse engineer the firmware, which you can get it from the website, or you can reverse engineer the firmware from the EEPROM chip or JTAG if it's present inside the PCB board. So where they got the password and the telnet session. So your entire range of all the devices will be compromised. Yeah. So it was like a tweet which I always loved it. So it's where, what will you do if you want to build a smart home? So the reply was like, you just invest a lot of money in the gadget and then prepare to patch all the security holes in all those devices. Yeah, so Internet IoT is like really secure. Yeah, so before I start with a little bit of technical, let me give you a small example, like a case study, not a case study, like a test case. So I think I was in Sydney to pentest a coffee maker. So the specification of the coffee maker is like, let's say it has a BLE, it has a Wi-Fi, and then it connects to your local, let's say, corporate network. And then wherever inside your corporate network, or if it's connected to the internet, you can just access the coffee maker, or you can brew your coffee anywhere from the world. I don't know why, but yeah. So I was supposed to pen test and find vulnerability. So I opened the device, and then I found that it's basically running a Linux machine. So that's typically like a router. So inside that, I found a small connector. So that's called a serial port. So serial port is like a backdoor, like a hardware backdoor to a device. So it's mostly for service personnel where they can go inside the serial port and then debug the problems. So what I found is, so it gave me a complete root access inside the device. So I really got the root access. So the first thing which I did is I checked for any credential, let's say just by having this coffee machine, now I get the password of your entire corporate network. So imagine just by having a small Wi-Fi based, smart coffee maker, so the entire company's network has been compromised. So again, the thing is, again, it's just a small thing how our typical pen testing works. But our hacker works, it's right now, you have your network credential or whatsoever of your corporate network. So what I would do is, so if you look at it, your coffee maker will have a processor and it's a relay and it'll have a coil to heat the coffee or the water. So what I as a hacker would do is, so for example, the coffee maker is somewhere inside. I have created a small exploit inside it so that, if you look at your normal home, so if you turn on your drilling machine or your coffee maker, you might see a small fluctuation in your power signal, in your tube light or in your TVs. So what I can do is I can literally trigger the relay in such a way that I can also transmit the whatever the critical information by triggering the relay. So that will modify the power fluctuations in the system so that even outside the office, I can just plug into the power supply and then monitor all those harmonics. I can just get the password or the important data out. That's one simple example. So because a typical hacker, that's their primary work. So they use all kind of creativity. So yeah. So the second thing what I can do is I can obviously blow up the coffee or the machines nearby. So if you are good with physics in your high school, So if you pass a frequency of a high current to a coil, it'll obviously got EMF. So that you can obviously create a huge amount of EMF in the coil, and then that might either blow the coffee machine or the devices nearby. Yeah, so. So how you can learn? So what I would really suggest is, so if you have a, if you're building a hardware product, and then if you really want to pen test it, or if you want to check for the security vulnerability, I would really suggest is just don't let your developer to really check the device. So obviously they'll be biased. Also the way they think is more on technical aspect. Whereas a real hacker or real-time security or your who is going to attack your system will use a different kind of arbitrary techniques to get in access to your device. So always, if you want to really pen test your device, do it to a third party so that they are not biased with your ideas or with your product. Yeah, so let's get a little deep on the real IoT itself. So, so one of the things which I'm really fascinated about the IoT as a whole, it's because so far the human being have invented like everything. So, but IoT, what I feel IoT is the combination of everything. It's a software, it has hardware, it has radio, firmware, cloud. So it's a combination of everything that the human have so far invented. And also that's also another problem which you might face. So it's like multiple connected nodes. So even if you have a small vulnerability in one single node of, let's say, radio or firmware, so your entire system gets compromised. So it's really a complicated situation if you are dealing with your security for IoT devices. So you might give a small, strong encryption in your firmware, but your radio is so weak, so anyone can decode it. Then the whole point of having a strong encryption in your hardware or your firmware, that becomes void. Yeah, so firmware, it could be for your processor or a controller or hardware. Your software is like your normal typical web app, mobile application, or network-based vulnerabilities, or radios like your Zigbee, Z-Wave, and all those stuff. And cloud is basically your AWS or your Heroku, or even your normal Raspberry Pi where you host your local local cloud here. Yeah, so let's start with the firmware. Yeah, so what exactly is a firmware? So according to me, firmware is something, anything, it doesn't have to be a code, it could be anything that makes a hardware brings alive. It could be a small blink program that you put it in your Arduino. So that's a firmware which you bring alive to the hardware. So that's something, it works for everything. So let's say your controller, processor, SoC. So every single device, if it's a hardware, every single device will have a firmware. Whether it's a TV, fridge, router, your smartwatch, even your industrial ICS and SCADA devices, every single device has a firmware. Yes. So now the problem with firmware is, so the first common problem which people make is, people hardcode every single information inside the firmware. So let's say I was pen testing a smart switch. So inside, I mean, I could say that that's one of the best example I could say for an insecure device. So what they have done is they have hardcoded the root password. Also, the funny part is the particular root password is common for all the devices. So imagine if one single device has been cracked, there are a lot of cracking tools where you can use the shadow file. It's a Linux subsystem where your password is being splitted into like password and then shadow. It's like a hashed version of your password. So there are a lot of tools like John the Ripper where you can do a brute force attack and then you can find the password out. So once you have the password out, then your entire range of IoT devices is being hacked. So also the second problem is the firmware upgrade. So most developers think that that's going to be the end of the product. I mean, the end of the firmware. So you just build one single firmware and then you enable the option of upgrading the firmware. So the problem with it, it's not like a software where you give a patch every single day. So once your hardware is out in the market, so you can't really go there and then do a firmware check, or you can modify the device. So it's possible, but it's like too, super expensive. So even before you write your firmware, make sure you enable a way or some kind of a way where you can do a on their update or regular update where a user can patch it if there's a new security vulnerability, and they can like secure the device. And the third one is like integrity check. So as I told you, OTA update. So few devices do have OTA update. The problem is the OTA update, people really doesn't encrypt it. Or they still use HTTP to just send a what the firmware upgrade. So if you have HTTP or insecure connection, so what I can do is I can simply use a burp suit or some other tool to intercept the firmware. I can download it somewhere else, and then I can use several tools like firmware modification kit or else some other tool where I can really modify the firmware inside it, and then I can craft a different firmware where I can open a new telnet session or netcast session, and then again I can put the same firmware back to the device, and then I can poison your entire device, and then your device has been compromised. And then last one is that's more like a logic flaw, vulnerable function. So if you know something called buffer overflow, let's say you have an input field in your device, let's say that asks for your Wi-Fi password. Right now your Wi-Fi password is, let's say, Arun. So Arun is like 5 character. So what if I put more than 200 character? So what if there's no buffer limit, and then that might overflow the buffer, and then that might return back some other information. What if I craft the packet in such a way that I access a different memory location, and then that could even reveal my shadow file or a password file or some other critical information inside my device. So it's more on the logic flaw and how you build your firmware around it. Yeah, so as an example, so this is from a smart switch. So basically, there's a tool called as Binwalk. So where you can extract, so you can just get it from the online, or you can reverse engineer the mobile app, which gives you the OTA link, or you can just search in their website and you can download it. So Binwalk using Bitcoin, you can literally extract the firmware. So the smart switch is from a D-Link. So D-Link is basically a Linux. So if you extract it, you can literally see it's basically a Linux partition. So it has your normal etc, home folder, where, www. So in that case, what I can do is I can just extract it, modify whatever the script inside. I can repackage it, and then I can again push it to the device, and then your device is compromised. Yeah, so example, this is from D-Link. So this is the telnet password of all the D-Link router. Okay, sorry. Yeah, so this is a telnet password. So they hard-coded it inside the firmware itself. So it's constant for all the D-Link firmware. So the second one is also for AES key, which they have hard-coded it inside one of the ARM libraries. And then the third one is what I told, the shadow and the John the Ripper, where I got the root password back. Yeah, so how do you protect it? So what I would suggest is, like, if it's really critical credential, make sure you encrypt it. Also, even saving the AES key, make sure it's not like obvious, like you just can just go do a normal search in the assembler and then you can find it. Also, yes, as I told you, make sure there's an integrity check. Make sure there is some kind of a checksum or where to understand whether this firmware is really being tampered with or if it's really the original one. So if you still want to make your device secure, so what I would suggest you is, like, start building your entire framework from RTOS. So the whole point of having a secure device is not like building a 100% secure device. It's always about giving hard time for the hackers or the attackers to make them understand your device itself. So if you use RTOS, the entire architecture is something which you built. So obviously it'll be hard for the hackers to understand the architecture, even to find vulnerabilities in it. So third, I told you, don't hard code any sensitive information. And then the last one is don't use any third party SDKs. So let's say you use some third party SDK for security or some kind of a video encoding. So the vulnerability in the third party library will completely collapse your entire architecture. And then before you even launch your firmware, make sure you audit the firmware from somewhere who's an expert in it. Don't make your the real developer test your firmware. So second one would be your software. So software is pretty straightforward because it's been there for like several years. So it includes your mobile application, iOS, Android, and your normal thick client like your Windows, Mac OS, or different one, and your web application. That's obvious. Yeah. So as I told you, like, it's been there for like, it's software is the first bug which you can easily find in a device because there are a lot of research already available. And then there's something called OWASP, where they have already released a set of vulnerabilities, most commonly used vulnerability, and how you can prevent it. So if you're a developer who is really developing a mobile app or web app, make sure you go through all the top 10 OWASP vulnerabilities, and then you build something just around it so that your device is really secure. Yeah, so The problem with web application is one of the common, web app is one is insecure authorization and authentication. So if you look at the classic example, which I could say is like baby monitor system. So I think down like last year, I guess, that's from a big company. So they don't have a good authentication mechanism. So what happens is like each baby monitor will have a unique ID. So whoever has an ID can get a live feed. So what the attacker does is like they randomly switch between all the randomly like do a randomization of the ID and then they get a new baby feed. So literally a guy can literally just modify the ID and then they can access the entire the library of the baby monitor there. And the normal command injection. So this we found it in one of the smart TVs where if you put a there was option to put a Wi-Fi AP, right? So in there, if you put a reboot or a system command, so that really gets executed in the backend. Basically, it's a Linux machine. So if you put reboot there, so that will literally reboot the entire TV itself. So that's something similar to your normal command injection that you will typically see in all the in your most of your web application. Yeah, and then the mobile application. So the good thing is like even iOS or Android, it's like very simple to reverse engineer it and then decompile it. There are a lot of websites or tools like Jadex, a lot of stuff where you can decompile it. So once you decompile it, you can find a lot of critical information. So smart switch, which I talked about to you earlier. So the OTA link of the HTTP link of the OTA link is being hard coded inside. So I just have to like search in the whatever the extract and then I got the HTTP link. And then I can download it. I can even modify it, and then also push it back to the device. So that's why, like, I could even save password, staging URLs, or API tokens, etc. So as an example, where in the app they have literally hard coded the password of the server itself, the file of the file in the server. So that's how IoT devices is happening right now. Yeah. So, so how do you really prevent it? So the first thing which I would really suggest is like, even as I told you, even before you start your project, so what I would really suggest is like, make sure you keep an element of security also in your architecture. Think from all the different perspective of your devices or your app or your web application can be really attacked. Also make sure you don't use any third-party library and depend on it. Check if you really want to use third-party libraries, make sure you check its security, whether you can really trust it. Then lastly, there are a lot of scanners available where there are a lot of tools available, automated tools. There are people who do manual testing where you can really go and give it to people, whereas they check it whether it has vulnerability or not, how you can rectify it and stuff. Yeah. So the third one, hardware, and my favorite part. Yeah. So people are still using consumer grade hardware like Arduino, Raspberry Pi, and then what could just go wrong? Let's say Arduino, Raspberry Pi, people still like say startup, they start with Arduino and then still they want to use Arduino. So I'm a fan of Arduino, but Arduino is just an educational kit. So it's mostly targeted educational industry, let's say kids or someone who is not good in electronics to understand it, to collaborate, to use electronics in different fields. So you can still make it as a commercial product, but there are a lot of cons and pros in using it. So yeah, so. So most common is like a short version of what the common vulnerabilities you can find. So one is your serial debug port, so which I talked to earlier regarding the coffee machine. So the second one is your JTAG, third one is your EEPROMs, last one is your side channel attack. Yeah. So serial debug port. So what exactly is it like? As I told you, it's like a small hardware backdoor. So if you carefully notice, there's something called as RxTx in the first row. That's basically your receiving and transmission. So it's more like two-way communication. So where there are devices like we have own tool called as Attify batch, where it supports multiple protocols. So where you just connect your TX to RX and RX to TX. So it's more like a small bridge, USB to serial bridge, where you can literally access whatever the data coming from the device to your laptop and then communicate with the device. Yeah, so what you can do is, as I told you earlier, so the coffee machine, which gave me a root access. Similarly, let's say your router. So your router, most of the routers will give a root access. So maybe you can try it at your home by opening the router. You might see like four small holes or small test pads. So that might be your serial port. Maybe you can try to see what's happening there. So that's a case where it has, it doesn't have a root access. So there are situations where it will not have a root access. So at this case, there are ways it even you can boot by doing a small kind of a hardware hack, like say glitching a EEPROM. So you can actually go into the bootloader. So just like in your Linux, it has a bootloader, right? So in the bootloader, you can actually change to force it to boot it as a root. So you can also do that to get access to the device. And then once you have the root access, so you literally own the device. So once I own the device, I can craft a small exploit that will create a backdoor or maybe like sending your password or your critical information back to my server or somewhere because it's a router. So it has an internet connection. Maybe I can, it's a Linux, right? So I can run anything, literally anything in it. Yeah. So next one is a EEPROM. So here I have a story for you. So let's say, so EEPROMs is basically like your hard disk of your device. So right there, you might have a controller or a processor. It will have a very small amount of your ROM. Let's say 10 KB, 12 KB, or 16 or 32. So that won't be enough. So let's give an example of, let's say you have a glucometer. The specification of the glucometer, let's say it's BLE connected. So the BLE is connected to the mobile phone. Mobile phone is connected to the cloud, where doctor can actually see the list of your readings and then give you a suggestion based upon it. Also, the extra feature which they have mentioned is like it also supports offline saving. So even if the mobile is off or it doesn't have Bluetooth connectivity, it will save up to 5,200 reading. So it means the data is being saved somewhere else. So that's obviously they will save it in an EEPROM chip. So what I as an attacker would do is I will get a new device or the same device. So I will remove the EEPROM chip. So, or you can just solder it. So there are tools like Attify batch, which can read SPI EEPROMs, I2C EEPROMs. So once I dump the data from the EEPROM, so I can see all the data present there. So what I can do is I can simply change the data inside it. Let's say I can make sure that all the data is like healthy, super healthy. And then I will just put the IC back in the device. And then there's a small pin called as write protect. So if I remove it, so the device can't really write anything there. So whatever I have written once, it becomes hard, it becomes permanent. So what will happen is, so even though the user uses a normal reading, and then even the reading is like so critical, so the whatever the reading in the EEPROM goes to the server and then goes to the doctor. And the doctor will think like the guy or the girl is fine, and then the guy's like really dying. So it's like super critical. Yeah. So yeah, what you can do with it, you can find a lot of credentials. Some people even say password or hashed password inside the EEPROM, where you can simply go there, modify it with your own hashed password, and then you can use it in the device to authenticate it. Yeah. So the second one is your programming port. So if you look at the second row, so this is the JTAG debug port. So why people really need it is because, so once you manufacture your device, let's say your PCB is ready and then you assembled it. So the controller or a processor is literally empty. So using these ports, so people really program it and then ship it to the customer. So what people know, what the common mistake which developers do is they don't really lock this port. They'll keep it open. That becomes really problematic. So you can access it similarly using the same Attify batch, Prosperit, or their similar toolchain. Yeah. So what you can exactly do is once the JTAG port is open, so you can just dump the entire firmware out. So, and then also dumping is also one thing. Also the critical thing is like, you can literally do memory modification. So this port is specially for programming and debugging, right? So you can literally modify the internal registers. So one of the example is like, there was a smart, okay, let's not name it. There's a device where I need to serially authenticate it. So it has a JTAG port open. So what I would do is I would just create a breakpoint at exactly where the string comparison happens. So let's say I'm comparing the test with Attify. So it will exactly stop at string compare of Attify and test. So what I would do is like, I would just go into the inside register, let's say the R1 registers, R2, or I mean, there are different registers inside your architecture. So I can literally go inside and see the real password, or else I can even change the password and then I can authenticate inside the device, and then your entire device also compromised. Yeah. So it all comes to the firmware based vulnerability. So how do you deal with all the hardware thing? So for example, serial or JTAG. So as shown in the image, you don't really need to put it there like saying this is a serial device, this is a JTAG device. It's more like inviting hackers to hack into your device and then like take over your device. So you don't need to put it there. So instead of putting it in a single row, you can just put it in a different location in your PCB board. You don't need to use a silkscreen to label that this is a this one. Maybe you can label it, let's say test point one, test point two, or test point three. Then you don't really need to reveal anything secret in the serial port. So maybe you have a different authentication mechanism for service personnel to even get any kind of data inside it. That works too. Yeah. So the last one is side channel analysis. So this is like a very interesting topic, and then how it really works is, let me give you a scenario. Let's say you have a PS2 keyboard. So inside it has like four wires, your 5 volt, your ground, and your clock, and your data. So whenever you press a button, a sequence of code goes through your data line. So the data line is also near to your ground, right? So if you know the high school physics, so whenever current flowing conductor is near a wire, it also leaks some of the current and then that gets induced in your ground. So that means whatever data you're sending, it's also being leaked to the ground. So all your devices are neutrally grounded, I mean all common grounded. So what if I just use the common ground in the room and then I can sniff the packets out, sniff whatever the transmission happens. So I can do that. So how you can do it? So you obviously need a very high sampling MSO because it happens in so fast, like you can't use a normal cheap, like low quality sampling rate, which is like super hard to understand. And also there are tools like Chip Whisperer. So it's being Colin O'Flynn. So he created a complete tool which does the process of both the high sampling MSO and the frequency generator. I think it costs around like $250. So what you can really do is, as I told you, you can really monitor the micro power consumption details. Let's say there's some kind of a AES encryption happening. So what if you send a known value of string and that's being encrypted? Maybe you can calculate the power consumption and then see how the power is consumed, and then you can convert into a real digital value, and then you can really decode the AES hardware AES itself. Let's say in the Chip Whisperer, you can literally break any hardware encryption that's there in Atmel, let's say. So it's already been broken. Yeah, and also there's something called as clock glitching. So clock glitching is where, let's say, your controller processor needs a clock. So it's more like a synchronization clock. So what exactly happens is in an ARM pipeline operation. So in the first clock, your first instruction gets loaded. In the second, it will get the second instruction loaded, and then your first executes. So what we can actually do is, let's say we are doing a string compare of a password, and then instead of just giving a huge pulse, what if you give a small pulse? At that point, your controller, the small pulse, it will detect like it's being loaded and it's executed, but it doesn't have much time to finish the operation. So it will obviously skip that particular the execution operation, and then let's say a string compare like A comma B, and then that particular thing is completely skipped, and then whatever the logic behind it, let's say your password authentication success, and then that will work. So it's one of the Chip Whisperer which I have tried. So it's more on serial console. So we tried glitching it, and then I got a successful response where I can again force into the any serial device. It's just by using monitoring the power and the clock frequency. Yeah. So how do you deal with it? Mostly it's very hard. Also, what you can really do is maybe you design your board in such a way that the leakage from the IC is really complicated. Because in a PCB, if you look at it, there are a lot of bus that's happening. So if you want to just capture one particular data line, it becomes a little complicated. So maybe you can make sure that there are a lot of capacitors around it so that you can reduce all the noise. Also, make sure you are designing the PCB in such a way that you don't really give access for anyone to really tap into the controller power supply or any of that. Or else you can simply remove the name or the label in the chip so that the attacker won't even understand which one is which, because he can't find the pinout, right? The last one I'm going to talk about the radios. So everyone loves wireless. Erroneous wireless, right? Let's say your wireless headphones or your smartwatch or anything that works without any kind of strings. Yeah. So today I will talk a little bit on the most commonly used protocol. Now I won't go deep in, like, let's say Wi-Fi, because it's been there like several years. So people have already cracked it, like everything there in Wi-Fi. So I will talk mostly on like which people use mostly use in the IoT devices. Let's start with typical RF. So RF is the most cheapest radio communication, which you can find in most of the devices. I think in most of the US, the most of the door alarm or the bill or everything uses typical RF because they are cheap. The model hardly cost you like less than $1. So how it works is they simply modulate it. The basic frequency modulation or IM modulation or on-off keying modulation. So these are like since it's a cheap, so the modulation or the protocol is like so simple. So the problem with this is like it's very prone to replay attack. So one of the best example I could say is, let's say car key fob. So your car key fob works on a basic RF since it works on battery, and then it's been there like a long time. So yeah, so what you can really do with the key fob is, what happens in the key fob is, like, for every key press, it transmits like, say, 32-bit key or a 64-bit key. But the problem is you can't save the key because it has a sort of a rolling code where it has a pattern. So the code changes for every single key press. So I think something was done by Sammy Kakar. So what the hacker will do is, like, let's say you have a car and then you are trying to open it. What if I jam the frequency? And then we have strong receiver, let's say RTL-SDR or USRP. So where you can actually like copy the whatever the jam signal, and then you can really reprocess it. Then you can get the unused the rolling code. And then once again, you can unjam it and then let the guy go. And then you can use the same code. And then you can get access inside the car. So the whole thing the setup can be done with less than like $15. So hacking a car is like very, very, very simple. Yeah. So it's an example of one of the car key fob. So it's like a small genie radio. It's like sort of like a MATLAB, but it's mostly for wireless. It's a small algorithm which I have done. It works at 430 megahertz. It's a commonly used frequency. So where I really got the key of the key fob, so I can simply replay it back using a small normal Arduino and a transmitter, and then I can take over the device. And then like almost all our cars with the key fob, and then every single car is like vulnerable to this exploit. Yeah. So how do you deal with it? What I would really suggest is, like, don't even try to go use a typical RF. If you still want to use a typical RF, make sure you have some kind of packet counter or something which really checks whether the packet is really valid or not, or else you can build a proprietary protocol or some sort of a modulations where it's really hard. Let's say you are LoRa, so LoRa the modulation is completely different. So that then it becomes safe for you to use it. Yeah. So the second one is your BLE. So BLE, as I told you, it's most commonly used right now everywhere. It's BLE, BLE, BLE. So I would really like to talk about how insecure the BLE technology really is. So it works just like a Wi-Fi. So it also works. It's like super low power. Even the range is low. Let's say like 20 to 30 meter max. Yeah. So the problem with it is, like, most devices, let's say you have a smart bulb. So they really don't have any kind of encryption mechanism or a pairing mechanism. So what you can do is simply you can do a man-in-the-middle attack where you can simply clone a MAC address of the smart bulb, and then you can take over the device. That becomes like super easy for anyone to clone it. So there are a lot of tools. Let's say you can do the same man-in-the-middle attack with just using your normal laptop Bluetooth device. There are tools like PTLE Juice, a GAT attacker, where that will create a man-in-the-middle attack framework itself, where you just need to select the device and then it does everything. And then you can see the packets there, and then you can do a reverse engineering and then see how it really works. Yeah. So in case of devices like which has a pairing, let's say your smartwatch. So if you pair your smartwatch, so it'll say like press this button in your smartwatch or swipe this in your smartwatch. So what really happens is like there's a key exchange mechanism happens. So that's sort of safe, but even there are ways you can even get those keys. There are devices like, say, Ubertooth, and there are a lot of sniffers where you can just dump entire packets. So the difference between Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, as I told you, the Bluetooth, it's signal hops for every single data. So it hops different channels. So the Ubertooth captures all the packets in all the channels. So it captures literally all the packets in the particular Bluetooth spectrum itself. So once I have it, there are tools like Crackle and so many other where with all those packets, you'll search for the LTK and SDK. So once I have the LTK and SDK, I can just clone your mobile phone or whatever the device you have connected. And then I can take over the device. And we also reverse engineer a smart bulb. Yeah. So as an example, so we used Ubertooth to capture all the data. So here, if you look at it, it's basically using a normal L2 cap. That's your BLE protocol, your network layer. So yeah, where is it? Yeah. So where, if you look at it, the UID is what the handle. So we tried a trial and error where we changed the color of the BLB bulb. So based on normal doing a normal trial and error, we found that this particular handle is being changed when we change the color in the mobile app. And then the value is this. So we did again a trial and error and then found out this is a header. This one triggers the on and off the bulb, and then this one RGB value. So once I have this, I can, anyone can, even from my laptop, I can control the device. So anyone can control the device from it, and then your device is vulnerable. Yeah. So how do you deal with it? So as I told you, you can use a custom based UID, or else you can encrypt it. But the problem with encryption is it again goes to binary or hex. So it's a little complicated there. So what I would really suggest is to make sure you create a multiple handles, and then for each operation. So maybe you can use different handles or different operations. Also make sure you use a hardware based pairing. For example, the bulb, which I told you, there wasn't any real pairing mechanism. So as I told you, maybe you can keep a small button where if you want to pair with this particular device, you have to press a button, and then that really hard codes the MAC address of a mobile phone. So then only your phone can actually connect to your mobile phone, to your the bulb. Yeah. So the last one is your Zigbee. So Zigbee is mostly used in industrial based like a wireless network or multiple node network where you have multiple sensors connected, then it gets connected to a master gateway. So Zigbee is also similar to Bluetooth, but the protocol is still more tangible. It also works in the same Wi-Fi frequency, and it works on IEEE 802.15.4. So the range is like a little bit moderate. So based upon the power consumption, there are a few Zigbee devices which works for till like 1 to 2 kilometers. Yeah. So is it really safe? So Zigbee itself, there are a lot of protocols which are built over Zigbee, but the base Zigbee is really not vulnerable, is really vulnerable. So it's susceptible to replay attack. Let's say the typical example of this is your Philips Hue bulb. So I have Philips, like a couple of Philips Hue bulbs. So they have been keep giving me updates like every single day. So even after all this, if I do a replay attack, so there are sniffers like Killer Bee, Atmel, RZ Raven, where I can copy all the packets and then I can do a replay attack. I can take control of the device. It's that simple. So it's very simple to even clone. So once I have the dump, I can find the PAN address of the network, also address that's present in the entire network. So, and then I can program my own Zigbee to communicate with there or change my MAC address so that all the packets comes to me. And then I can control or understand how the real communication works. Yeah. But if you really look at it, the IEEE standard, it really supports hardware encryption. I mean, the MAC layer encryption, but no one really uses MAC layer encryption because it makes them to build everything from scratch. Whereas Zigbee, they can just, there are a lot of stack where you can just put it there. So it makes them really like vulnerable. Yeah. So how do you deal with it? As I told you, you just need to like encrypt it, encrypt the MAC layer. It's I know it's going to be tough, but trust me, it's really worth it. So if you just encrypt your MAC layer, then it's really good. Yeah. So there are a lot of security modes in your Zigbee network itself. Security modes like you can just put authorization, encryption, and that you could see it if you read the real specification of Zigbee. Yeah. Also regarding the replay attacks. So what you can do is you can, as I told you earlier for Bluetooth, maybe or you can create a small counter where it will only check for the real valid packets. If it's out of the packet counter is out of out of the sequence, then you can really like suck the packet, and then you don't really need to like worry about it. Yeah. So I hereby conclude by saying like IoT is secure if you really work for it. And also we have this small PDF which gives you a small gist on the list like OWASP 10. So we have published our own like top vulnerabilities in top 7 vulnerabilities, all those secure IoT security architecture as a whole itself. So you can just download it from this website. And then thank you for Intel Innovator team and the entire Be My app for giving me this awesome opportunity. Then I can now go to the the questions. Okay, I think IDA Pro would be a good option. Yes, I agree. So IDA Pro is more interactive. So the IDA Pro, it's really good. If you consider Radar 2 is like really heavy, but for a basic operation, I would really suggest you go with IDA Pro because the UI is really good. So if you want to search for a string, there's a small option where you can just directly go there, find all the strings. The smart switch, which I told, so the library, they just did a strings in the IDA Pro and then I got the ASP. So I would always suggest you go with IDA Pro. Yeah. So I want to hack a smart home security. So what are some things which I can do? So mostly the hacking, it'll wait to say hack a home security. Maybe you should tell it like what are the parts which you want to hack it. The home security might have a Wi-Fi, it might have a cloud, or it might even have a firmware based. So you need to check for start with your web application or mobile application where you can find something critical, and then you can go to the hardware and then firmware, and then you can step by step understand that which exactly the part of the security home system which you can really hack it. Yeah. So which one is better in terms of security, Zigbee or BLE? So which one is better is it's, if you look at it, the both are insecure. So it's all in how you architecture the device. So for example, Zigbee. So as I told you, you can use a MAC layer encryption and then you can make sure that the device is like completely encrypted. So even if you do a replay attack, since it's encrypted, even the packet frame is also encrypted. So your replay attack won't work. And similarly for BLE, as I told you, you can use a pairing or you can use a specific signal hopping frequency where only you know the frequency. Frequency is the pattern of the frequency. And then that might really help too. Yeah, so do you recommend using a C Linux system to secure a IoT device? Yes, but the problem with RTOS is like, if you're really care about your IoT devices security. So maybe what you can do is you can start building it from scratch. It's going to be like super expensive. It's going to consume a lot of time, but I would really recommend you build something from scratch instead of using a custom framework for all, like people are right now, companies starting like framework for IoT. You don't need to code anything. You don't need to do anything, but trust me, the security is like, it's very easy to find vulnerability in all those devices. Whereas if you use a RTOS, The as I told you, the whole point is giving tough time for the attacker to understand your system, right? So once you have a RTOS ready, then the attacker will take a lot of time to even understand your architecture. So then your system becomes secure. So how vulnerable is communication in cellular development boards like SIM900? So SIM900, to be hardware specific, it's basically just a normal SIM transceiver. So it works just like a mobile phone. So there isn't much difference between a SIM900 or a typical mobile phone. So there are a lot of hacks already available, not like hacks, but the problem is in few countries, whatever the message or the audio which is being transmitted, it's encrypted. But there are few operators or in few countries where the encryption is not there. So there are a lot of tutorials where you can just hack a GSM network by using $10 devices called RTL SDI, where you need to build a small algorithm around it where you can really find the frequency or the local transmitting frequency of your local network. And then you can literally find the keys for it. Yeah, so what about LoRa security? Is it safer than BLE and Zigbee? So LoRa, if you look at it, LoRa is basically it's like a built over a typical RF. So as I told you, they have created a proprietary protocol under modulation. Whereas in a typical RF, the modulation, let's say the frequency is same till the end. Whereas in LoRa, the frequency hopping differs. So I could say like, it's safely, it's better than BLE and Zigbee because the entire architecture is completely different. Also, the LoRa is also proprietary. So even for you to understand the real LoRa, the real hardware stack, it becomes a little complicated. So I would say like LoRa is like a little better than BLE and Zigbee. So VXWorks in terms of security, I think VXWorks is a typical RTOS, right? So I think VXWorks, I haven't worked with VXWorks, but then I think they do have a good security framework for it. Maybe you can try that. Yeah. Okay. Is it possible to capture the cellular traffic and decode it? Yes, it's possible. As I told you, there's a device called as RTLS. I mean, that's a cheap. There are other devices like HackRF, USRP. They're pretty expensive, but for basic sniffing, let's say your 2G network, so you can use a RTL-SDR to sniff the packets. Yeah, okay. So you can decode your cellular traffic and then decode it later too. Yeah, so the next question is, okay. So I want to use an RFID tag with a directional reader, which is a signal strength to only communicate with object less than 3 meter. It's not attached to the network. Do I need to worry about the hacking? So RFID, it's already been hacked. So since you're using just the signal strength, so maybe if someone in the vicinity can really keep a small sniffer, let's say a EMF sniffer, maybe he can understand the architecture, maybe he can bypass it, or else he can try to jam the signal, or else you can do like a lot more stuff with it. Yeah, it's, you need to really worry about the hacking. Okay, what's the most secure protocol? Secure protocol as in with respect to hardware or software or network, you need to be a little precise on what exactly the protocol you want to talk about. Software, with respect to IoT, I think CoAP offers a better security. So, I mean, still there are a lot of vulnerability, not like vulnerability, there are a lot of flaws in how people write code around CoAP. So I think CoAP is like, you can like always select CoAP if you want like really choose security. I mean, since CoAP is becoming, you can still, HTTP is also secure, but since IoT device mostly relies on MQTT and CoAP, so CoAP is more, right now it's mature than MQTT and different protocol, where it offers a better flexibility for you to like implement security, or even you can implement security above your protocol layer. Is it more secure than HTTP? The context changes, right? Because HTTP is mostly for web-based, whereas IoT, if you see the real communication, I mean, right now people still use HTTP REST protocol, but down the lane, let's say 3 to 4 years, the amount of bandwidth which the HTTPS take place is going to be huge. And then whereas your embedded device is not powerful enough to like to process HTTPS, let's say, so the context changes. So I think it depends upon what exactly you want to build. So if you want to just still use your HTTP, I think it's secure. If there's a pairing in BLE device, how can it decrypt it? So as I told you, there's a device called as Overtooth. So where you can actually like capture all the entire frequency spectrum from your, I think from the 60 frequencies. And then there the key exchange might happen, not those frequencies. So the Overtooth helps you to capture all the dumb data. And then there's a software called as Crackle. So where Crackle finds exactly where the SDK and LTK file is there. So LTK and SDK is more like a, public and the private key. Let's keep like private and public key. So once you have that key, you can actually emulate or craft your own patterns there. You can decrypt. You can also decrypt the packets which have been transmitted already. And then you can understand how the transmission really happens. And then you can build a custom exploit over it so that you can take over the device later. Okay. Yeah. So is it possible to perform side channel attack to capture a key exchange while pairing? Yes, it's possible. So yeah, it's like super possible, because the good thing about in a BLE device is like your device is obviously going to be, let's say, a low power footprint, right? So the processor is also like low power. So whereas if you just monitor the power consumption, you can easily see whatever the operations happening. There, as I told you, there's a tool called as Chip Whisperer, whereas it has like all the config like set ready, whereas you just need to like connect it to the power pin of your controller, and then you can just easily like decode the any kind of transmission happening in the controller. You can just decrypt it using the device. Is there a specific resource you would recommend to learn more? Maybe you can follow our blog. So our blog is blog.attify.com. So we do regularly post on the exploit which we find, or the vulnerability which we find recently, and then like create a blog around it. or else you can just follow us in LinkedIn, where you might find like more like similar stuff there. Okay, do you think there are a lot of people with hardware and software background to break into the I2C bus or even build a null modem cable? So I2C bus, I don't think you don't need to break into I2C bus. I2C bus is like almost similar to any other serial protocol. So you can just reverse engineer it, and then like there are like logic analyzer where you can literally see what's happening in the any other I2C bus. And then from there you can understand how communication happens, and then you can create a small interceptor, or you can create a third party device where that can emulate as the real device, and then you can take over it and then do a normal man in the middle attack or like any more such devices. Okay, I think my time is up, I guess. So once again, I would like to thank everyone for giving me the super opportunity like to talk about what exactly I do, and then you can just follow me in LinkedIn, or you can just follow me at Attify. So I really like thank you all.